According to Le Chatelier, changing a condition of a reaction at equilibrium will favor the reaction that counteracts that change, or something along those lines, but you get the point. So if you consider an exothermic reaction, for example, the hydration of calcium oxide, the negative delta H indicates its exothermic nature. And remembering the reason why the reaction is exothermic is because the energy required to break the bonds in reactants is lower than the amount of energy released from forming the products. That is, enthalpy has decreased. Now, according to Le Chatelier and his counteracting change thingy, decreasing the heat of this reaction at equilibrium will favor the reaction that will reduce this decrease in heat, which is the forward direction. An easier way of thinking about it is if you consider the heat loss as a product, but it really isn't. At equilibrium, concentrations of species are constant, so if heat has to be released, but you take away that heat, the forward reaction is favored so heat can be produced. And vice versa, if you increase the heat, too much heat after equilibrium will favor the reverse reaction, so not too much heat is produced. But really, how can this be best explained? Well, a typical reversible reaction is when the activation energy for both forward and reverse reactions are relatively low. That's why they're reversible. And essentially, if these are low, the reaction may be able to reach equilibrium in a closed system. This graph demonstrates the forward exothermic reaction, whereas this graph shows a reverse endothermic reaction. Now, if the forward exothermic reaction has a higher enthalpy, the activation energy is even lower. Check out that hump right there. It's now shorter. This means that the activation energy for the reverse endothermic reaction is comparatively much higher. See this hump? It's much larger. Now, an increase in temperature of any system will lead to a higher rate of reaction in both forward and reverse reactions. This is because of collision theory and etc. But if you really think about it, if you take an endothermic reaction, for example, the cobalt chloride equilibrium that you did in class, just to mix it up a bit, and pump it with more energy in the form of heat, there is a greater proportion of reactant molecules that can actually react, which essentially drops the concentration. And over time, as its concentration continues to decrease, its rate of reaction will also decrease. But remembering, at the same time as more of the reactants react, more product is formed, which increases the concentration of products. But just like the forward reaction, its rate will slow down until a new equilibrium is reached. This means increases in temperature affect the percentage of particles able to react in endothermic reactions much more than exothermic reactions. Or alternatively, just remember what I said before, it's much easier.